So as we know, a lot has happened in the world over the last 18 months, and that also means in the land, quote unquote, of DEI, in the world of diversity, equity, and inclusion, a lot has happened there too, where organizations all of a sudden were like, wait, we're supposed to be doing DEI work? Have we been doing DEI work all this time? And what does it mean to actually shift to having a commitment to DEI? So organizations have been like, let's put together a council, a committee, a task force, a working group. You probably have even a different name than what I just named there, and have said, let's put together this council who can help us build out our entire DEI function of our business. But the reality is, as you've started to see, and as we started to see councils being built out, we've started to see that every single council doesn't actually have a strategic intention for what the work really looks like. And some councils are out there and they're like, I don't even know where to begin with doing this work. I've been told we need to build a council, but what does that actually look like? And then there are other groups who are saying, we have a council, we're doing some work, but we're not actually sure that it's leading to actual change. So we're seeing an influx, regardless of the size of the organizations, where councils are coming in and saying, hey, we're asked to build this council so we can build our entire DEI function. How do we actually do this, and where does the council come into play? So you're probably in one of these stages, and I want you to think about this as I'm describing each different stage that we're seeing of councils, and just jot down for yourself. It'll be a question I may ask you later on in the Q&A, but I want you to jot down for yourself, where do you think your council is right now? So maybe you're at the beginning where you're just beginning the work of creating a DEI council, and you're just unclear where to start in building a strong foundation. You're coming to sessions like this one. You are out there and you're like, all right, let me Google everything I can figure out. Does anybody have a resource guide? Is there an ebook? Is there a tool? Can somebody tell me what's the best way to do this so that I don't mess this up, I don't waste any time, and my council can actually be a strategic council? So you may be there. You may be in what I like to call the alignment period. And this is where your council has started and you've been doing work, maybe for a year, maybe for 2 years, but it just kind of feels like you're just going in circles, like trying to get aligned on why you exist in the first place, what your goals are, how your council should even operate. And you're spending a lot of time just having conversation that is just circular. And you feel like, can we not just like do the work and move? Instead, it feels like circles. Or you're in a place where you're starting to realize, like, wow, we've had this council maybe for a year, 2 years. We've seen this with organizations. I'm working with an organization now where it's been 3+ years that they've had this council, and they're realizing now that all the members of the council actually aren't on the same page with what they see as the work, what the work of building DEI in the organization is. And now you're spending all your time just trying to find internal alignment. And you're like arguing and debating, like, should it be diversity? What's the definition? You're like, wait, we spent the last three meetings talking about the definition of diversity. We're out of alignment. So that could be a place that you're in. You could be in a place that I'm just going to call the event planning stage of a council. And y'all, I was thinking of all these different other ways to describe it, but I'm a pretty blunt person. And this is the reality that I see a lot of councils are in. This is the phase where your council is doing this. What? You have a DEI culture calendar that tells you all the different cultural holidays and experiences and things that you should be honoring, which you should. But you're spending all of your time meeting and planning the next upcoming event. Oh, July is this, August is this. So you're spending all your time doing that. And you know that you could be doing more, but all your energy is going towards basically you have become the DEI event planner for the organization. Or you're stuck in a place where your council is like, let's read a bunch of books, let's watch a bunch of movies, let's go to a bunch of webinars, let's, you know, like read a bunch of additional like articles that people send out. And so you're engaged and you're like, oh, we're learning so much, this sounds so good. But now you're in a place of information overload where you're like an overload of resources space because you're not sure how to apply those resources. So you're just in conversation over and over again. Or you might be in this place of where you're kind of like what I would call the beyond the vision phase, where you've created a DEI vision statement, you've had some trainings, and you've even formed some additional committees, or you've even gotten to the place where you're beyond a DEI council and you now have employee resource groups. But you're recognizing that it is still not leading to actual shifts in your organization, And you're wondering, have I created too many structures? Are too many people involved? Is it going to allow for us to do the actual work? Because we have a vision, but we're not realizing that. The final stage that you might be in is the what's next phase. You're recognizing your council has done a lot of great work, but y'all, it is busy work. It's not strategic work, and you're trying to figure out how to shift your council into an actual strategic decision-making body that leads the organization into real change. What do I mean by busy work? You're doing all the things that I talked about on the previous slide, and it's all busy work, but then you're turning around and you're like, huh, why do our surveys still say that individuals who identify as non-white in an organization still don't feel included in the organization? It's because your council might be doing a lot of busy work, but they're not doing strategic, intentional work. So no matter where you're starting, you may be realizing, and why you're here having this conversation with me today and listening to me for the next 40 minutes or so, is that you're realizing that the critical impact that your organization and your council actually could have on your business strategy, and you're realizing that you're in a place of something needs to shift in how it currently operates, and you're tired of trying to figure out what are the proper steps and how to stay versus get unstuck. And this is a very intentional edit here, because I think there are a lot of times where councils are like, all right, I'm here, Dynasty, because I want you to teach us we're stuck, and I want you to get us unstuck. And in my mind, I believe that it's more than that. I believe that it is my role, my job, my team's job to not teach you how to get unstuck, because that, y'all, is temporary. It's my job to teach you how to stay unstuck and to anticipate where you're gonna get stuck and how to make sure that you get ahead of that and remove that barrier along the way. That's the job of a council. Now, this whole conversation is because, as someone who has actually built and led an entire DEI function, I was in charge. It was my title to say managing director of equity. So it was my role to lead the entire DEI business function. But I still leaned heavily on the council that I had within the organization, even though I had an entire team, because I believe that councils can be incredibly powerful because of the diverse perspectives that it can bring together to both inform and drive the organization's DEI work. I truly do believe that each of your councils can transform an entire business. However, I think that a council in itself, because of all that power and diverse perspective, can also be its own biggest barrier, its own biggest Achilles heel, if you don't realize what's happening with your council and how to stay unstuck. So as you're reflecting, don't drop this into the chat. I want you to keep this silent for yourself, but I want you to be thinking about, where do you think your council is right now? As I was describing those journey points, where is your council? Where do you think that you need to move next in order to not just get unstuck, but stay unstuck? So keep that for yourself. We're gonna talk about this more, because I just wanna talk about how do you shift councils into strategic communities. And then I'm gonna talk about an additional piece that I think many organizations and councils miss that keeps them from actually getting to the place of strategy. So let me give you an analogy, and then let's jump into the actual framework. So I just recently purchased a home, which is very exciting, stressful process if you've ever done it before. And I was thinking about the work that we do in a council, in a DEI, in DEI work. And what I see a lot of times with a council, a DEI council, is they're kind of like you're building a house, okay? And in my mind, you wouldn't want to build a house that doesn't have the foundation 100% complete. So you wouldn't do something like this. Hey, y'all, let's get together. We're gonna build this council like we're building a house, and we know we gotta have the foundation, because everything on top of it makes sure that the foundation is solid. It won't fall, it won't crumble, we're good, right? But you wouldn't come in and say, all right, we've gotten through building 30% of the house foundation. Let's go upstairs and build the bathroom. Let's figure out what the paint should look like in the like downstairs bedroom. Oh, have you all thought about the faucet sink in this particular bathroom? What sort of sink do we need? Or should we have a tub in here or not? You would complete the foundation first, because it doesn't matter what the faucet looks like or what the bathroom looks like, or if you're gonna have stairs or it's gonna be split level, whatever the case, because your foundation isn't 100% complete. The idea with this particular framework that I'm gonna walk you through is that every council needs to make sure that they have these five core elements and they're working on them to make sure that their foundation of their own council house, if you will, is 100% complete. So as you're thinking about this, I don't want you thinking about this as like, oh, we need to be like 10 steps ahead or this is going to be in 5 years. These are elements that I consider foundational pieces so that you can then build and shift and move in a lot of different directions with your entire organization. So the Strategic DEI Council Framework consists of five different elements. We're going to walk through each. This is where if you've got paper, pen, grab it. You're going to take lots of notes. You'll also have a chance to access the recording afterwards, but just so that you've got pen and paper, it may be helpful for you to think about this. Now, you'll notice at the top of this framework, there is the word intentional. And we're going to be using this a lot of times throughout this framework, because I think that there is something about if you want to have a strategic DEI council, that everything that you talk about and do has to have intention behind it. There is no like just general, oh, let's just think about how we structure the council. There is an intentional process, and that intentional process has to be tied to who your business is and how your business operates. A lot of times councils, even before we get into the framework, get stuck because they're looking at organization A, B, C, and D and being like, well, they're doing that over there, we should do that. Or they're doing that over there, we should do that. Or I noticed that this other organization already has a council and five different ERGs. We need all those ERGs right now. No, you don't. You need to think about intentionally what is right for your organization, what helps you, again, build the foundation first. Because again, if you're running around and you've got six different committees and councils and all these things, and you don't have these foundational pieces, guess what? You are actually going to see at times you're going to get stuck, or you might actually see that whole council crumble because you haven't built fully the foundation. So when you see this word intentional, it's because I mean, think about the intentionality of how it applies to your organization. Get a little bit of tunnel vision, stop looking at what everybody else is doing, and think about what works for you and your actual business. So let's go in and let's talk about each of these pieces. So the first piece is really thinking about the council's role. And the idea of thinking about the council's role is to define your purpose, because it's providing a North Star that you're coming back to. Now, when we talk about this, I want to be clear that we are not talking about the responsibilities or how you set up like, oh, we're going to have eight people on the council. We're going to get there. Don't worry. We're going to come back to that. But it is different to talk about the role, because when you talk about defining the role of the council, you're not just saying like, hey, there's this generic statement out there. You are actually having clear agreement, sometimes with your leadership team. Sometimes you're doing this just with your own council if your leadership team is a little bit behind you, which we can get into in the Q&A, where you're talking about, why do you exist as a council? What happens if you don't exist? Who does the work? What happens to DEI? Do you actually need a council right now? You might have 20 people in the organization. You're like, we need a council. Well, if 10 people are on the council and you're an organization of 20, do you really need a council, or do you need just all 20 people to be working on DEI? That's a real question. So why you exist and what happens if you don't exist? What outcomes are expected from you? This is where you're getting an agreement as a council. Like, what is our role? What are we going to do? Can it change over time? Yes. But for at least the first year or two, it is so important that you agree upon that, because guess what? That's what you're going to come back to over and over again when you start seeing all the other shiny objects. Oh, we need to work on this. Oh, I see this over there. We need to go over here. You need to come back to the center and say, no, 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 these are our outcomes. This is what we're focused on first. We can add that to the list of things we're going to do later, our running long list that continues, but we got to focus on this first, because you don't want to get distracted. And again, what? Only build 30% of your foundation. What are your DEI operating principles? How are you going to show up as a council? How do you all operate with one another? What's the organization's DEI core beliefs? And what's the org's commitment to making sure the council does not become the only DEI space? Over and over again, I see councils where, guess who's doing the work of DEI? The council members. Guess who should be doing the work of DEI in an organization? Every single person, period. And so if you are not having a conversation early on about how do you make sure that you are keeping the lens of not just about the council, but about beyond the council and into the organization, you are gonna run into cases where the rest of the organization is gonna be like, why are we doing this work? I don't understand why I have to go to this training. Oh, I'm not bought into this. We need to step back and look at this again in a different way because you haven't had that conversation. So what does this look like when you think about this? When you have role and you've defined those things, you actually have clarity. That's all we want you to start with. It's just like, let's get some clarity in the room, okay? When you don't have the council's role clearly defined, major misalignment can happen about the role and intended impact of the council. All of a sudden you've got different leaders and people across the organization who are not a part of the council being like, well, y'all should do this or y'all should do that. It becomes this random sort of mosh pot of things. It's like a potluck. You just bring a bunch of stuff in. You're like, oh, we got to eat all of this, when you really don't, because you're like, if we define the role, then these are the things that we're going to focus on first. And when you think about this, if you don't have the role defined, you could actually stall here. You could actually get stuck here, and you could get stuck here a year or two into the council existing, because you're starting to realize like, wow, we're trying to do everything. And now that we're in a place where we're like, we can't do it all. It's too much. It seems overwhelming. It seems like we're not moving the needle. We got to go all the way back to the role and redefine it. So I'm going to describe to you an organization that we worked with over the last year through an intensive program, and we're going to call them the team for today, but we're going to talk about like what happened for them and what they experienced. So the team, when they were doing this council work and they started this work with us, they started to realize that they had found themselves making great progress only to realize they were getting stuck for months, which is why we came in trying to figure out why they couldn't actually work on the things they had identified because they hadn't defined the role. What does it mean to define the role and shift to a strategic role definition? This means defining your core beliefs and operating principles. It means having role clarity dialogue spaces where you're talking about as a council with your leadership team, if you can get them into the room, what is the role? What do we expect the role to do so that you can always go back to those operating principles? And then create a council operating chart. You notice I did not say an org chart. That's later. You need to think about how the council will operate. And if you have now a council, you've got ERGs, you've got a DEI manager or VP, you've got another executive who's like the sponsor of DEI. You want to create an operating chart to talk about not the org structure, but how everything operates together so that it's clear. You know what the objectives are, you know what the outcomes are, and you're not getting into this place of like, whose role, what's the role, how are we aligned? Get clarity. The second piece of this is now you can think about the structure. Remember I told you they are two different things. So now you've got the role defined, you've got clarity. So now you can think about the actual structure of a council. And y'all listen, the structure of a council is a really important piece because the reality is, the structure can either create pathways or it's gonna create barriers to getting real work done. The reality is that you can create your structure any type of way, but you need to be thinking about, does the structure help us support our goals, the outcomes that we identified in our role conversations? Will it lead us to doing the work that we need to do? Or are they a bunch of different layers that actually become barriers? This is where I ask organizations. I just had this conversation the other day where I said to an organization, you have 15 people. Why do you need a council? You should not be paying me or anyone else to help you build a council, because in your 15 people, you can do this work. So thinking about the intention of your structure and how it works. When you have structure, you have not only clarity now, but you've got alignment on what the work is and how things work together. What happens when you do not have a clear structure in place and you haven't defined what that structure needs to look like? Well, one, you can have major misalignment with other council members, with staff and leadership on how the council should be operating. So similar to role, but a little bit different. You might have lack of representation and lived experience in the council. Have you ever seen a council, and maybe you've experienced too? I definitely have experienced this in my work where I was in an organization and it was like, hey, whoever's interested, just join the council. And we never stop to think about like, do we have people that actually make the decisions on budget and have the ear of the leadership team on the council? Do we have people from different backgrounds and perspectives? Is this a council, let's just be blunt, of mainly all white people and just a couple of people of color? So there's no actual representation and lived experience in the council. What does a council look like? Thinking about that, being intentional about that structure matters to, will you be strategic or will you not? Lack of clarity on how decisions will get made and by whom. Y'all, legit, I thought about putting this on its own slide because I think it needs its own like 50 to 60 minute conversation, but we don't have that much time today. So when you think about this, who is making decisions? And not just like who is leading the council, but who actually gets to make the decisions? If it's people that are on your executive team and you don't have anybody in the council room coming to those meetings from the executive team on a monthly basis, on a quarterly basis, on a frequent basis enough where they know what's going on and they're engaged and can help move decisions along, you're in a little bit of trouble. I hate to tell you, but I just wanna be honest. There's a little bit of trouble there because you are going to get stuck over and over again trying to figure out, like in our structure, who actually makes the decisions. So you defined it earlier. The other thing is, you might see in a structure where people are focused so much on individual needs rather than the collective. Have you seen this? Where someone says, you've got a group of council members and it's like, oh, hey, as a council, we need to focus on all these different things. And you know what? I am really passionate about performance evaluation. And someone else is like, oh, no. I am passionate about compensation. But because we don't have a clear structure in place and clear outcomes that we've identified from the role perspective, we can't say to folks, that is great. You should be passionate about. Keep that passion. Don't let it go. We're going to get there. But we're going to operate with this first, and we're not going to start to spin off 20 different committees to talk about compensation or work plans, to talk about all these other things that are focused on individual needs and desires versus on what does the collective organization need right now? And what do you need to actually build the foundation? So this team that I was talking about, they spent that first year, again, we came in and worked with them about 2 years after their council was together, where they said, you know, we spent our whole first year not worrying about the structure, right? But we weren't getting any work done, only to find ourselves then spending our whole second year defining the structure and still not getting any work done because they were so focused on all these different elements they had not taken the time to really dig in and think about what does intentional structure actually look like. So what does it look like to shift to a strategic structure? That means operating in service of your defined role, meaning going back to what is the role of the council and then creating subgroups and subcommittees and plans and outcomes based on that because you know what the overall outcomes are based on how you define the role. Representation and inclusion of marginalized voices. Can't say this enough. You cannot be making decisions as a council about people in the room without the people in the room. So it's either they are council members or you are actively and proactively including them often in conversations, but making sure it's not a council of individuals worked with a council about a year ago, all white, trying to make decisions for the people of color in the organization doesn't work. And the last is, have you defined in your strategic structure the decision-making and power dynamics? How have they been defined? Who's making decisions in the room? How does the team do work? And how do they actually get work done? And are there layers that they're gonna have to go through? This is so important because organizations and councils in particular get stuck over and over again because they never had this conversation. Please, if you have not yet, you need to have it with your leadership team and you need to have it soon, especially if you're a council that has been running for a year or two, because if you don't, you're gonna continue to get stuck over and over and over again with everything that you wanna do because you're trying to figure out the layers versus like, can you just decide and then we can move forward and move into strategic work. 3, education. So you cannot build the council first and then not develop the people at the same time. Y'all, one that I see over and over again, where councils spend 100% of their time and budget in the first few years at working to attempt to change business practices. So this is like, yeah, so what's your council working on, Dynasty? So I ask this question and people will say to me stuff like, all right, Dynasty, we are working on hiring and recruitment. We are going to create, you know, a new pathway, career pathway for people in the organization. We're creating some additional ERG committees and this is gonna be great work. Cool. Is your council actually educated? Do the people on your council actually know what it means when we talk about diversity, equity, inclusion? Do they know what it means when we talk about anti-racism? And are they on the same page with their own knowledge and growth? That's one. Two, is your leadership team getting educated? And not just your leadership team, but the people who are over departments who make decisions for their department. Why does that matter? Let's take recruitment and hiring, for example. Saw a council. The council said, hey, we're going to work on recruitment and hiring, and we know that we need to do something different, so we're going to work on it. Council goes off, they do all this work on it, but the person who makes decisions about recruitment and hiring, not in the room, not brought along into the education side of things. So they're like, what in the world is DEI? I'm over here doing my thing. I'm not worried about it. They go to this person. They're like, hey, we've been working for 6 months on this. Here are the changes we want to see made. We're pulling you into the conversation. And that person's like, no, no, no. That sounds crazy. That's not the direction I want to go in. I don't want to do that. Why? Well, because they haven't been brought into the conversation along the way, but also because the council didn't recognize that every individual is going on their own DEI journey in parallel to the work that is being done. So if you spend your time educating the council first and only, and not the rest of the organization, particularly those key individuals that make decisions, guess what? You're gonna get stuck, because then you're gonna have to spend time bringing it all the way back and being like, okay, let me educate you. Let me spend the time to educate you, get your buy-in, when if I had thought about it and I was doing both along the way, we could be moving forward with next steps. It's a big difference. The last is with your entire organization. Because again, what did I say at the beginning of the call? That it's about transforming the entire organization. And from a role perspective, it's about making sure that you aren't so focused on inwardly just the council that you aren't thinking about the rest of the organization. Because what can happen is the council can be doing all this education and getting their own education on and like learning, doing all this work. They're like, oh, we got it. We figured it out. We're in this certain place. And they look around them and they're like, let's roll it out to the rest of the organization. The organization is like, what? No, I'm not doing that. I'm not bought in. And it's because you weren't bringing them along the way. So you have to plan for all three. How are you going to educate folks and bring them along the whole way so the council is not burdened with doing the work? It is about everybody being engaged in DEI work. So if you just focus on one for a while, your team's gonna feel ill-equipped to lead this work on your own. And then you as the council are gonna start to get burned out and burdened, because you're like, wow, we're having to do everything for ourselves. Why is no one getting this and digging in with us? It's because the council is saying, yeah, we, you know, like the rest of the organization is saying, yeah, we don't get it. We're not there with it. We're not sure what to do next because you haven't brought us along in the process. So who do you need to think about educating in strategic education? Yourself, your council, because if you're in a council and you've got people who aren't aligned on what diversity is or what inclusion is, and you debate that over and over again, you're gonna spend your time stuck debating folks. And the reality is, y'all, you may not realize it in the beginning because you're like, wow, why do we keep getting stuck, or why do we keep arguing over this one question? It's because everyone hasn't been educated and we haven't had an alignment conversation to make sure not only are we educated, does everyone agree? This is how we're seeing this. This is how we're operating as a council. So get your council educated. Educate your leadership and department leaders along the way. Not later, not after, not 2 years later, but educate them at the same time you as a council are getting educated, and then also do the same thing for your organization. Two more that we're gonna go through. So work. Now, all of that, and you're like, okay, but Dynasty, wasn't that all work? 100%, that was all work the council is doing. But now you can actually talk about, okay, what is the actual work that your council will do? This is important because why? You wanna see things happen. You wanna see transformational change happen, and you wanna be strategic about it. But y'all, I know you're thinking like, but Dynasty, work should be the first one, but it actually shouldn't. Because here's what happens. If you skip the first three elements of thinking about role and structure and education, and you just jump into the work, guess what? You're gonna be pulled back in to those other three over and over again. I see it time and time again. And then you're like, dang, why can't we get any work done? Well, it's because you're back over here because you were like, no, we're gonna skip over this. It's taking too much time. We need to like show that we're showing results. And the reality is you're going to show results from doing those first three things first as well. But don't get stuck in like, we got to go for the work and not think about the other three first. So the work is your actual roadmap. And what does strategic work actually look like? I'm going to talk about that next, but I want to name that if you don't have the work clearly defined, there's a couple of different things. One, you as a council can 100% spend all of your time working on one thing. This is where you get into that event planner mode, instead of being able to strategically address multiple things at the same time with an organization. The encounter council can be working on all the wrong things and spending their energy on work that won't lead to real change. This is where the council comes in and you're like, what should we work on? You're like, well, I think it should be this. I think it should be this. And you're like, yes, that sounds good. And you start working on it. And then you're like, why is this not leading to fundamental changes? It's because you don't have an informed perspective of what you actually should be working on as a council. It's just based on individual perspective and need. And that's one opinion, but it doesn't give you a full picture of what is going to actually shift and change the entire organization. And the last is the council can become the only people engaged in DEI work, which can lead to lack of buy-in and engagement again. So how do you shift to strategic work? You define the work and big outcomes. That's the first thing. So like taking the role outcomes, what's the role of the council? And then thinking about, okay, now that we have the role of the council, what does the work look like? What is our North Star? If we're thinking 5-10 years from now, think big, y'all. What do we want to see? What looks different for us as an organization? So that's one. The second is define the work beyond a calendar. So get away from just those event cultural calendars. You can have a subcommittee that's just doing that work. But as a council, if you find yourself spending 75 to 80% of your time just planning events, you are not doing strategic work. You are doing busy work, or you're becoming kind of bona fide event planner. And then define the work through your equity data. This is where I encourage all councils to do an equity assessment of some sort, whether you figure out how to develop one within your organization or you have an external consultant lead you through one. An equity assessment is going to give you clear data about what you should be working on as an organization. And let me be clear, an equity data assessment is different than saying, we do a DEI survey, how inclusive do you feel? No. An equity data survey says, let me go and pull your compensation reports. Let me go pull your promotion reports. Let us look at the quantitative data tied to the qualitative data. And let's talk about what the data tells us, what the story tells us, so we can get in and figure out where do we actually need to solve for and what does our work plan actually need to be about. Too many times I see like, oh, we're gonna ask a few fuzzy questions on our all staff survey and that should be enough and then we can figure out what we're working on. But y'all, how much information do you really get for when you ask a question like, do I feel included in the organization? Well, it could be yes or no on a scale of 1 to 5, but it's not gonna tell you why. It's not gonna tell you in what ways. It could be that your promotion process is the reason why people don't feel included. It could be how people are showing up and onboarding to the organization. But without that additional information, you don't know. And so you are working and could be solving for a lot of wrong things. Now, could you just like think about good examples and look at other organizations for DEI goals to try? You could, but it could cost you a lot of time, money, and failed resources, because what one organization needs to work on may not be what you need to work on as an organization, and therefore what your council needs to focus its attention on. Last one is thinking about the communication aspect. And this is where you need to make sure that you have an intentional strategic plan for how your council communicates to its internal and external communities the work being done. I underline this question here because I love asking this question to individuals who are not on councils in the organization. Hey, what does your council do? The wide range of comments. And I know what the council does because I spent a little bit of time with them. But the wide range of comments that have nothing to do with what the council does. I think the council eats lunch together. I think they meet once a month and they talk about, they have a book club. You know, I think they plan some events. They planned this Juneteenth event for us last month. That was really great. So I think that's what they do. They focus on that. And meanwhile, you and the council are like busting your butt. You're like, oh, how do we think about building an equity assessment? We should do a survey. We should do all these different, you know, trainings and communications. And your organization's like, I have no idea what's going on. It's because, and I put it on the council, you don't have a plan for how you're gonna communicate. This matters just as much as education, because if you're in conversation constantly to the leadership team, to partners in the organization, to those in power, to the entire organization, guess what? Then the organization can stay involved, the organization can stay engaged, and the entire organization can help lead the DEI work, so it's not just the council. It also creates a level of trust and buy-in that you won't get if you're like, oh, well, let's just like keep it in our back pocket and not tell them what's going on and have real conversations about what's happening. Now, this team that I work with had spent that first full year thinking about how they work together and doing a lot of things that kind of set them back. And then they realized in that second year, they had to spend that full year re-engaging the rest of the company because they didn't take the time to talk to them about what was happening within the council. Again, be strategic, be intentional about this. Tell people so that the work doesn't fall on just you as a council. And guess what? It leads to change faster because people know what's going on. They know how they can get involved, even if they're not a council member, and they can help push the work along, not just you. So I think about this as, what are the strategic conversations that you're having? Not just like formal, a newsletter that you send out, but who are you getting like a tea chat with or a coffee chat, a virtual Zoom with? And as you do it, you're remembering like, oh, on the agenda, as I talk to this person, I wanna put a bug in their ear about some of the stuff we're doing in the council so that they can know and they can be like, how can I get involved? How can I do that too? You're doing that at the leadership level, you're doing that at the organizational level, and you're also doing that from a council perspective because y'all need to be in conversation with each other. The most powerful councils that I have been a part of, that I have built, that I have experienced and led, have been council conversations where they're not just coming in and being like, okay, y'all, today, what is on our work plate? But they're actually sitting down and conversing with another and saying, hey, do you see what happened in the news? Let's talk about that. How do we feel about that? What if that happened at our organization? How would we reflect on that? How are we pushing ourselves to think about ways differently? Right now, a council that I'm working with is having a deep conversation over the last few months about how might they compensate BIPOC individuals for emotional labor. That is a deep conversation, but the way they got there is they started having conversations that weren't just about like, let's check the box, has everyone reported out on the one little thing they're doing in the work plan, but they're having deep conversations, not just about the work, but also about like how they're showing up in the work, beliefs. You wanna think about that full picture. And so this is why I call them conversations and not just like communications, because people automatically go to a newsletter or a monthly email. Those are transactional spaces. If you wanna get into a relationship, because DEI work requires relationship, and you wanna transform your organization and transform people, you need to be in conversation and not in transactional communication spaces. So just a quick reminder, we're gonna go through a few more slides. I'm gonna talk about the intensive and I'm gonna open it for questions. So if you've got questions that are starting to percolate, you're starting to be like, oh, this is a lot of information and I wanna ask this question, start to drop those into the chat. I'm gonna remind you about this a couple of times because we're gonna move pretty quickly through some slides here. And I wanna be able to answer those questions at the end of our session together. So the reality is, y'all, you can do all five of these pieces on their own. You can focus on one, and each one legit by itself is powerful. But combined, you're gonna create that strategic transformational group that you're actually looking for if you're thinking about how do we build time in and build a work plan around making sure that we are addressing all five as a council in our work. There's one more thing that I gotta layer on that you must have. And this is where I'm going to encourage you all quickly to think about this intersection of tunnel layers. This is where we started to talk about that house and you're like, let me go build a house and start on the second floor first. This is where you get into a conversation, see this all the time with councils, where they get into conversation and people are like, okay, we need to focus on race. And then someone else is like, oh, but we need to think about gender too. Oh, we need to think about like accessibility too. And we need to think about this too. And all of those things matter 100%. I'm not saying that you should remove any of them for the conversation, but you gotta have a little bit of tunnel vision and think about how you're gonna layer conversations in. I hear you that we need to talk about age and gender, but let's talk about race first. And then let's spend some time making sure we're clear, we're aligned, we've got the education there. And then let's layer in the conversation around gender. Because the reality is, y'all, the difference is every single time it always leads back to race. And I tell people this. When we talk about even the isms, I show people this slide and they're like, oh, whoa. But when you think about this, you are layering on pieces. And all of these pieces matter, y'all. This is intersectionality. They all equally matter. But the reality is there are differences that people experience from a DEI perspective based on race. What a white woman experiences in a workplace is different than what a Black woman experiences. We have gender in common. We might have the same age in common. We might even have the same religion and ability and class in common. But when it comes to race, they are different experiences. So I always tell organizations, layer your conversations in, because otherwise you're gonna get distracted and be like, I need to have these 20 different things going on. And then you're gonna look up one day and be like, why are we like doing a whole bunch of like not focusing on anything? It's because you did not teach yourself tunneled layers and just get yourself a little bit of tunnel vision. Again, don't not just not focus on them at all, or just say like, oh, we're gonna focus on this one for the next 5 years. Don't do that either. But you've gotta have a little bit of strategic and tunnel vision about what you're talking about, because it will help you move the needle quicker and help you change things faster if you understand how these pieces should be layered in. You've gotta just move that. So remember this if you remember nothing else, tunnel over circular, where I think about circular is like throwing things out and we're going in circles and we never actually get to like, boom, what are we gonna work on? What are we focused on? Now, if you miss one of these pieces of the framework, those five pieces or those tunnel layers, it's kind of like what I would analogize to like a stool where you only got two legs. And then if you only have one of these, your council could fail at any time and be stuck consistently. And you're spending your time either going back to one of those pieces where you're like, oh, we focus on the work plan, but we need to go back again and again and again. And you're spending your time getting unstuck instead of moving forward. It also means that as a council, there are places where we see councils get stuck over and over again. Maybe you got stuck in the name. Yeah. Organizations, councils that were like, we spent 3 months on the name. That's a place where you can get stuck. Maybe you got stuck in the book club and the culture calendar where you're so focused on events. You're like, oh, but what's the work that we should be doing? Maybe you got stuck with the people. That can really happen where you're like, wait, we're not all on the same page as a council. We as people need to have our own education. Maybe you're focused on circular versus tunnel, or maybe you just haven't been communicating. And now people are like, you want people to do something different in the organization. And they're like, I don't know what you're talking about. I need to be educated before I will bring and be along in this journey with you. Or maybe you are stuck at decision-making, how people are getting information, alignment, lots of different areas where you can get stuck. And the reality is, you're gonna have intentional pauses. I am never gonna tell you that you're not gonna be a council where there's going to be red across the framework. It's gonna happen. But the reality is, if you know what's coming and you are using that five-step framework, then you can proactively say, this is not a stuck place. This is a place where we know we're gonna have to intentionally pause. We know that before we can move ahead in a work plan, we're gonna have to do with equity assessments. We're gonna need to pause for a little bit to do that work. But you are planning for that, so you are proactive to it versus being on the back end of it where you're like, I didn't know this was coming. So the council is stuck over and over again. That's the difference. And that is how you stay unstuck, by knowing the intentional pauses that are coming along the way versus not knowing because you're not looking at those pieces of the framework, and then you're getting stuck and having to go back and not knowing how to get out of it over and over again. I see it happen so often. How do you do this work? I think there's a lot of different ways in which we could do this work. There are five different things that we talk about in the intensive program that we go through and that we've been testing with organizations over the last year, which is we talk about the role design and we define the council role very specifically. We talk about structure and we get into what's the council structure, not just like the responsibilities, but the strategy, the selection, who goes into a council member, how do you launch it? So digging into those pieces. We talk about the education, how do you plan for not only for the council's education, but for the organization and for the leadership team. We talk about the work and what is the actual work plan. And we dig into the actual communication and think about how do you do intentional